My name is Pat. I'm the director of Living Web Farms. Living Web Farms is a nonprofit which mostly teaches sustainable growing techniques, anything that will give us tools for the future. And indeed, it's not like we're hoping things get harder. The good news is all of those tools are wonderful right now. They'll enrich your lives and enrich your communities if you, have a garden, grow medicinals, any of those things, Biochar is a little more complex, but all of them can be done. So if you want to, has everybody been to the webpage? If you want to know more about what we're doing, you can go to livingwebfarms.org, and there's a webpage with probably hundreds of hours of videos, I think, by now, right?
Yes, over 300.
Yeah. And there's a weekly radio show I do. We talk about gardening mostly, but we'll talk about baking. If you want to know about baking, call in. We'll talk about baking. I can answer your baking questions. To me, baking and gardening are pretty similar. There's many differences, but the huge similarity is that you must relate to a living thing. And you must relate to the fact that it is in an environment. And how that environment is massively determines how your bake comes out. So if you don't get that the bakery is really cold, you're in trouble. Your bread will have great big holes in it. I can tell you, I had 2 years of all winter long holes in my bread too big to sell the bread because I didn't get that my dough was way below 80 degrees. And so when I put it in the proof box, the outside of it got nice and warm and rose real fast, and this core stayed cold and it separated, made these big holes. And so I can save you that. I can save you that particular problem, but other problems will happen if you don't remember to pay attention to the environment. And so that's the way they're similar. Also to the fact that you're working with a living organism. The more you think of your bread as alive and treat it like it's alive and try to make it feel alive, the more it's bouncy in your hands, it's essential experience to work with it, the better your bread will be. So that's basically the similarity. Okay, so what we're going to do today, we're going to start by getting our focaccia sponge going, and I'm immediately throwing you a ringer. It's a ringer because you'll see in all the cookbooks, people don't make sponges for focaccia. It's what they call direct dough. There's two basic ways of approaching a bread recipe. There's many, many variations, I promise, but the two general biggest ways, right, are to make a sponge and let the fermentative process of making that sponge go, which will create more flavors and dough conditioners and even things that extend the life of the dough because you're making acids and acids will preserve the dough. And that is a really good technique. But then there's also a method called direct dough, which is just throw all the ingredients in a bowl, mix them up, and you go from there. Both of them are fine. I want you to learn how to make a sponge. The key reason why I'm using the focaccia to make a sponge is because I want you to experience watching the sponge and catching it at the perfect time. I have read a lot of baking books, and something none of them ever say that I learned from experience is there's a huge difference in breads if you catch your sponge on the rise, as close to the peak as you can get. If it sighs and starts to fall even a little bit, it's not quite as good. If it crashes, it'll be significantly less good. You can recover that by doing other things perfectly and still make a good loaf, even a great loaf, but it would have been way better if you could have caught that sponge at its peak. So that's why we're going to actually take a recipe that normally wouldn't be a sponge recipe and turn it into a sponge, and I'll teach you how to do that. It's pretty easy. Then you can take any direct dough recipe, if you have the time, and turn it into a sponge recipe. They'll always be better because that fermentative process creates all those things that I talked about. The other dough we're going to make, and these doughs are particularly chosen because they allow us to bake smallish things, which will rise faster and bake quicker in the oven. And we kind of need that with as many people as we have here and the time frame, which is actually, it may seem like a long class. Andrew could tell you I spent a week teaching people this stuff, It's a lot to try and squeeze into a day. So specifically, these doughs are for that purpose. The other dough we're going to do is called an old dough recipe, or in French, and I'm sure I'll massacre it, pâté fermenté. How would you say that?
That's pretty close.
Is it? Miracle. Anyway, I never had much faith in the old dough concept. I just thought it was cheating and would give you inferior results until I worked 1 year in transition when I was starting my farm up after I left Highland Lake Inn at Earth Fair for a winter. And all their doughs were old dough based. We would actually make a new dough at the end of the day if we didn't have enough old dough and let it go old. And the difference was great. They made wonderful breads because they had an old dough recipe system, which is much easier than a lot of the other starter systems, and a spectacular oven. Those two things made incredible bread. So we're going to do an old dough baguette. And the reason, it doesn't have to be baguette, you can make other things, but the bigger you make it, the less likely that we'll get it baked properly before it's time to go. So the advantage of baguettes is that they're small and they'll bake fast, you know. Both of these recipes, the doughs can be used for many things. We're doing a focaccia, but you could as easily do it into pizza. It'll make a fine pizza too. The very most important thing in measuring is that you get the salt right. The number two most important thing, and if you got it way off, it would be just as important, but usually you get close anyways, the water. If you get those two right, the rest you can do by feel very easily. How much yeast? Really, it's a crapshoot. Doesn't matter. It just takes a little longer or goes a little faster if you're off on it, you know. The flour, you're going to do totally by feel. And that's okay. It's time to give you the warning. You are going to make a wetter dough than you've ever made. How many people here have made bread before? Okay. If you haven't made bread before, it'll be easier for you, you know, because you will not be tempted to do what you always do, which is make the dough easy to work. Sorry, if you make great bread, the dough is not easy to work. I'm going to teach you lots of techniques that'll reduce the impact of that, but you want what in the professional world is called a well-hydrated dough. Hydration is what you want, you know. Absorption, you know, you want maximum absorption. The way we do that, the basic technique, and I'm going to demonstrate the first dough I will demonstrate to you how to do it. The way you do that is, it's why I like the bowls, okay? Two things I like about the bowls. One is I have a great talent for making huge messes. And if I make my dough in the bowl, I've contained a lot of my ability to make a mess. You know, the mess, and if you're not prone to make great messes, you'll be tickled that there'll be virtually no mess by the time you're done. It's all in the bowl. And I've had people take the class at John C. Campbell and write that the best thing about the class was the bowl. You know, they love the bowl, you know? Yeah. I have to take that as a compliment. It was my idea to use the bowl, you know? Anyway, so you'll have the dough in the bowl and you'll start with a scraper. I bought a bunch of scrapers so everybody can have a scraper. You'll use this dough scraper, and it's only, if you go to other like kitchen stores and stuff, they'll have variations on this, all of which look brilliant and elegant. I'm sure there are designers that love the sweep of their design and all that. None of them function nearly as well as this. This has been designed by bakers, for bakers, and it fits your hand, and it's an incredible tool. So everybody's going to have one of these, and you'll see me using it, and just try to do what I'm doing. A major temptation is to treat your dough like it'll break, or like it won't do what you want it to do. And you have to learn when you're working with a dough, especially a dough that you make wet, that you're the confident one. You free that dough up, you make a sweeping motion, you flip it, you know? You don't try and tease it up or something, or just get worse and worse, you know? You just free the dough up completely, scoop under it, and flip it, you know? And just trust it. If you flop a few times, nothing will happen. It'll be fine. But you'll get there, and it'll be easier to do it, okay? All right, so.
Patrick, how far south are we going to have to teleport to find 80 degrees to rise our doughs up?
We'll probably put it underneath these tables, I guess, or someplace, you know. Yeah. And we'll put hot water in there, and we'll be right there at 80 degrees. We could turn up the heat here and commit an ecological crime and be very uncomfortable.
And make enough noise that would drown out.
Yeah, right, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, we have to go ahead and work the other way.
Well,
yeah.
I knew you'd have a trick.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. There's no other choice. We have to have by the way, why Andrew asked about how far south we're going to have to go to get 80 degrees is because remember I told you the story about two winters with my bakery of making tons of bread that I couldn't sell? My way of learning is totally self-taught and figuring things out as I go. And so I got regularly this free subscription of baking, production, and marketing. 95% of what was in that book, that magazine, I could not use at all. It was all about mixes, you know, dough conditioners, all that kind of stuff I have no use for, you know, bleached flour, all that stuff. But that other 5% was golden. And I finally was reading an article, you know, featuring a baker, and they'd ask the baker at the end of every article, what is the most important tip you'd pass on? He said, keep your dough at 80 degrees always, and you'll have no problems. You know, it doesn't have to be 80. It could be 78, 75 even, 82, 83. But if you're way off from that, then you start getting those kind of structural problems. You know, the other way you could do it is you could keep your dough at 65 and give it much, much longer, so that it doesn't have this uneven rate, separation when the temperatures are too hot, too warm on the outside and too cold on the inside. So that is, it was revelatory to us. We went from weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth for two winters. I mean, just discounting tons of, you know, loaves of bread. I finally got Diane to agree that we could sell bread if the hole was no bigger than a dime. The deal was, if you could eat a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, the bread could be sold, you know. But once we figured that out, the bread was perfect every time. A sponge is all of the water and other liquids that can be fermented, okay? Oil cannot be fermented, so it wouldn't go in there, okay? But all of the water and other liquids that can be fermented. Note, once beer has been fermented, it can't be fermented, because and the alcohol would not be good for the yeast, so it would not be used. It has to be able to be fermented now. So things like milk can be fermented, you know, juices can be fermented, things like that, things that can be fermented, okay? All the liquid that can be fermented, half of the flour that the recipe calls for. Please note, that is not half of the flour you will use. You will use less than that for sure. But it's fine to use half of the amount that the recipe calls for to make your sponge, okay? And usually you use recipes that have this done for you already, but I think it's empowering to turn any recipe into a sponge-based recipe if you have time, because it'll improve the quality of the bread, okay? So all of the water, half the flour, and the fermentative agent. That is either yeast or sourdough starter, or some kind of starter. Sometimes they're not actually sour, but starters, okay? That's all you put in the the sweetener. If the recipe calls for sweetener, which this one doesn't, okay? But if the recipe calls for sweetener, that also goes in at this stage, because it can ferment. The idea is to maximize fermentation and let that sponge get nice and big. So Tom, if you will do, let's see, it calls for 7.5 cups of flour. So if you'll do 3 3/4 cups of flour, okay. And so 2.5 cups of water. Okay. While Tom is doing that, let's do a bowl count. How many bowls that we can use? This size bowl, too small. This size bowl, fine. Before I forget, when we get much further along, we're going to learn to slash our bread. And my favorite tool is a gardener's knife I get from Johnny's. I want you to know, this tool can hurt you very badly. I'm glad you all signed the consent forms. I haven't ever seen anybody lose a finger, but I've warned people before, and then I've turned around moments later and see that they already had several cuts. It's super, super sharp. So always use it away from you, cut away from you. Never hand it to anybody with the blade. Pay attention, okay? Don't use it for anything but slashing dough. This knife is not to be used for anything but slashing dough, okay? Two reasons: it's very easy to cut yourself if you're using it for the wrong reason, and you'll dull it. And we want a super, this is brand new. This one's gonna be sharp as can be. The sharper the knife, the better, okay? The last thing I'm gonna say, because I might forget to do it when you're actually slashing, I'll teach you more about slashing later on, but it's easy when you're slashing to catch this little nub at the bottom on your dough, so keep it out. Keep it up when you're cutting, okay? And the other thing I'll say right now about slashing, in case I forget to do it, is That is another one of these confidence things. You cannot tease your knife through the dough. You have to just do a motion. You have to just trust you'll make it work. And if you don't, the world will go on, you know, and your bread will still be fine. Okay, so who doesn't have a bowl? Okay. Your bowl will work. You're just barely there, you know, but you can make it work.
Pat, why is being accurate on your salt measurement so?
Okay, it's a great question. Salt has an incredible number of dough conditioning effects. Dough conditioners are anything. Yeast is a dough conditioner. Okay, you are a dough conditioner. You know, your motion is dough conditioning, right? But there are other amazing dough conditioners. Potatoes are an amazing dough conditioner for bread. Once the New World was discovered, baking changed incredibly in Europe. Lots of things. Potato changed tons of things about our world. And one of the things it did was allow bakers to extend their flour. Bakers actually have been incredibly reviled through history because they were between the Lord and the people. And so the Lord would put the pressure on them to, you know, pay a lot of money for the right to bake and all that, and also put tons of pressure on the people that they couldn't afford the food to buy bread, and the baker couldn't make money. So they amended the doughs with all kinds of things, including lead, because it was white, to get away with having to use the flour, which is too expensive. Once they got potatoes, they could put a significant amount of potato in the bread, and the bread was better. So that was huge, you know, and they stopped getting tarred and feathered quite as much, you know. Anyway, salt is one of these incredible dough conditioners. There's actually one place in Italy that doesn't bake with salt because they didn't want to pay the Roman tax for it, Tuscan bread. I want to warn you that you may be tempted to try making Tuscan bread sometime. I finally decided at John C. Campbell that I was going to tell people, no, don't do it, you'll be disappointed. For years I said, go ahead and try it. And I never had a time that somebody wasn't disappointed. We are totally used to the taste of salt in our bread. It is incredibly bland if you don't use it. It also is very prone to tear because salt strengthens the gluten. Okay? It makes the gluten stronger. It also, so it increases flavor, it preserves the bread, it strengthens the gluten, and it regulates the yeast. So if you don't have the salt in there, you'll always know. As it's going into the oven, you'll see these tear marks. Have you ever done that and seen it? Yeah. Okay, so if you put too much salt in, the bread's not only going to taste bad, but it's also not going to rise. If you don't put enough salt in, the bread's going to taste bland, right? And it's going to tear apart. It's going to fall because the gluten is going to be, you know, the yeast is going to go crazy. It's going to rise too fast. You're going to miss the proper proofing. And then it's not going to be able to hold together because the gluten's weakened. So that's why the salt is so critical, you know. It is, there's nothing more critical than the salt. It has to be perfect. Okay, and while we're waiting on Tom to find the yeast, which I shouldn't have set him up to not be able to find it, we're going to give everybody, Andrew, maybe you could do this, if you oil your hands and just tear off the size of a nice orange, okay a big orange, like a navel that you'd spend a buck for nowadays.
You bet.
Yeah. And once you get that, we're then going to go to the pate fermenté recipe, and you're going to put your water in. And then you're going to take this dough, and I know it's going to be hard to do, and you're going to totally destroy it. You're going to tear it apart into the water. You know, you don't have to go crazy. It doesn't have to actually disappear and go back to a slurry, but you want to break it up pretty well. Okay? And that's because it's the old dough, and it is not being used as dough anymore. It is simply a dough conditioner. So you've taken this dough, you let it ferment. I let it sit at room temperature all night, and then put it in your water, and it's a dough conditioner. You know? Indeed, I'm tempted to do what I've done by mistake several times because I almost think it makes a better bread. Maybe what we'll do is we'll cut the yeast back. We'll put some yeast in, but there's yeast in this, and it's very lively, so it doesn't really need that much yeast. And if you take this recipe with you, and by the way, I will find these recipes and can email them to you if you don't want to write them down. If you're at home and have time, just using the pate fermenté old dough part as your fermentative agent will give you a better bread. Because invariably, bread is best the more slowly it ferments. Okay? Cooler temperature, slower fermentation. This may sound counterintuitive from what I said about 80 degrees, but really, until you're ready to shape your dough. It's your final baking dough that should be at 80 degrees. Many sourdoughs and stuff like that will not be very good if you're fermenting them at 80 degrees. You'll be favoring the wrong sourdough organisms. So you can ferment them much more effectively at 68 to 72. You basically want to take your dough and put it into something like a proof box. And I don't expect people to build proof boxes, so you have to get creative. People can use their ovens. If you have a pilot light, it might be right there. It might be right around 80 degrees. But you could also just stick a good-sized pot of boiled water in there, and the steam from that will get both the dough likes to rise in a steamy situation, but it'll also warm the oven up. Another thing I've taught people to use is if you have a big cool ice chest, you can put that in there, put the hot water in, put a rack over it, set your dough on top of that. Be aware that it may be too hot on one side, so you may have to turn it because you don't want to get it above 80. You know, you just have to watch it and play with it. Other people have figured out that they can heat water up in a glass bowl in a microwave and then just stick the dough in the microwave, you know, after they turn it off. You know, but just they can heat their water up. That's, you know, I don't have a microwave. I don't use microwaves, but people have said that that works for them too. So somehow or another, you need a proof box to get your dough to 80 degrees. By the way, in the summertime, professional bakers put ice in their water because they don't want it to get to 90 degrees. You know, we had to always have refrigerated water in silo when we bake because the bakery would get way hot and our dough would have gone crazy if we weren't using refrigerated water. Did you find the yeast?
So I can try throwing these orange-sized pieces to you, or you could bring your bowl by and just get it.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
That's a 90 cent
orange. Yeah. Okay, so does everybody now have dough? Okay, then we're going to go to the water. 2 cups of water.
How long can you leave it?
There's actually a wonderful book called The Breads of France by Bernard Clayton, who also wrote The Complete Baker, Complete Book of Breads, rather. And he talks about a woman high in the French mountains who just stuck a piece in her drawer and then pulled it out the next week and used it, you know.
Oh, so a whole week.
But it was a cool climate, you know. You wouldn't do that in Asheville when it was hot out, you know.
Right.
But the temperature probably never got into the 70s, you know, way up there. And so you could do it fine that way. Yeah, it can go a long time. If it no longer is staying, you know, together, it's too far. It'll. And you may decide, like Tom, I think you had a batch of old dough that started eating your bread, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So he just, you know, he got the wrong microbes, and every time you put the old dough in, the dough just went slack because they were, this is something to know, is we're not going to do sourdough today because it's too hard, but I brought sourdough starter to give people if they want to go home and try it, okay? And I'll talk about it, you know, how to use it and what to do with it a little bit. But it happens all the time in sourdough. If you ferment too hot, like I said, or let your starter go too long, and I took some pictures to show you what that looks like, you can actually favor the protein eaters. The first thing to get active is the starch eaters, and that's what you want. The protein eaters are basically tearing out the walls of your bread because the bread is held together by the gluten. So if you take your starter too far, or even an old dough too far, you have selected the wrong microbes and your bread will be torn apart. It just won't, it'll go flat and be very sour tasting. We've all been there, right? It's no fun.
But can't you keep on using a starter by like taking some of the from that bread that you made then and saving that?
The ideal though would be to do that before you add it to salt. You don't have to though. Old dough is just dough, you know? So it depends. If you're trying to actually keep a starter rather than do old dough, then you leave the salt out, you know? It's not going to wreck it. This is actually wonderfully illustrative. I don't usually turn this into a sponge recipe, but I wanted to do it to show you a sponge. And I know all the time when I'm teaching baking, people come back to me and say, I measured out all the flour I thought I was supposed to use, but I listened to you and I didn't put it all in. And look at all the flour I have left. And they can have like 60% of the flour that the recipe called for. Recipes use way more flour than you need to make great bread. And that's just what's shown right now. He put half the flour in and didn't get a sponge. He got a dough. I did not expect that. I'm quite startled by that. And yes, I would recommend if you're trying to hit 80 degrees, you can get yourself really close if you take the temperature of your flour and then make your water a temperature that you think, you know, I don't usually sit down and do an equation, But I just use my intuition. Okay, if the flour is this cold, I should make the water 110 degrees or something, and I get an average, and it usually works pretty well, you know.
In case you've never thought about it, it's never good to take water out of the tap warm. It can be picking up heavy metals while it's hanging in the pipes. Better to warm it up on your stove and then mix it with cool water and get the temperature you want out of it.
Heavy, thank you for saying that. Heavy metals, salts, and most of us have plastic plumbing right now, and the heat is going to pull out endocrine disruptors and stuff from that plastic plumbing. So just stay away from hot water, you know, for that reason. If you're making water to warm up your proof box, it's fine to use hot water, you know, but not for your dough. Okay, so we're going to move along with the old dough. And the next thing we're going to do is the most critical one, okay? And I think actually maybe Andrew will have you do that too. You'll measure the salt for him so we have a standard thing, okay? There's a little. Okay, and a word about salt. We went with the low-priced option this time. I use real salt. It's like $3.89 a pound. There's also Celtic salt. I'm sure it has a slight positive impact on the bread because yeast likes to eat and likes to eat well like we need to eat well, so it likes the extra minerals. And it would actually make the yeast do a little better. It's not enough difference at all if the price is hard for you. I do it because I want those minerals myself, you know? So that's why I do it. You do not need to do it for the quality of the bread. The bread will be just as good. You know, the difference will be imperceptible to all of us, I think. I don't know that anybody would notice it. I'm sure there is a slightly more active, more vigorous yeast, but it's just not important. So
this is what we're using here.
Yeah. Yep. No, we're not. That Tom's doing that one. Okay. We're using this one here.
Yeah. I always ask twice.
That's very good. Totally. Yes, indeed. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Everybody's got a full load here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
That's for the pâté fermenté.
The critical thing, unless you're going to use a scale, and we just don't have enough scales here to do it, and I just learned to bake without a scale because I wasn't trained professionally. I taught myself. Professionals all use scales. They're way more accurate, okay? But if you're not going to use a scale, then you do not ever want to use anything other than typical table salt grind. You don't want to use kosher salt. You don't want to use pickling salt because both of those will give you different amounts, okay? The volume you're looking for is the volume when it's ground to the kind of salt that'll come out of a salt shaker. The French Food Co-op sells sea salt in the bulk bin, and it's meant to go in a salt shaker, so it's fine. You would not probably be in deep trouble if you use pickling salt. I've seen people get way off using kosher salt. It's just way too coarse, and they're using much less than they, you know. You'll be using a little more than you should use if you're using pickling salt. If you then measure carelessly, like, you know, heap the salt up in the tablespoon or something, you can get in big trouble.
Digital scale you can find for under $30, and they're, besides being accurate, they're a lot of fun to use. That's the only time I ever use them is bread baking.
Okay, and then we are going to put some of the yeast in. Probably not as much as it's called for, because I just don't think it's needed, because we have this very active old dough that we're using. So it's calling for 1 1/4 teaspoons. I'll probably put about a half teaspoon in, and I won't be very precise, you know.
Can you go ahead and do that?
Yeah, throw a half teaspoon in.
You're going to talk about yeast and what you'd like to use? Okay.
I never considered the concept that there should be differences in yeast. After teaching my first baking class at John C. Campbell, an article somebody sent to me came out from Cook's Magazine. They compared yeast and they showed differences in all that. I was like, wow, this is a whole new world. So I went out and bought different yeast. It wasn't enough of a difference that I cared, you know. Indeed, for several years I would go to Earth Fair because they used to anyways be willing to sell you the fresh cake yeast. And I thought for sure people are going to find it to be more powerful and make better bread. Nobody could see a difference. You know, I mean, the differences must be there. I'm sure this is going to be on the internet, and there's going to be some professional baker who will, what the heck does he know? You know,
you get a more sour flavor from the dry yeast, but I've never found that true.
Yeah, I mean, Cook's Garden said they're all differences in browning, differences in, and I tried it. You know, when I teach at John C. Campbell, I'm usually fired enough up about baking enough to bake for a few weeks afterwards. I bake at Christmas time. You know, I bake if companies coming. and I use one recipe that I can start quickly, and the old dough recipe, and have it taste good by the next morning, you know. At that point, though, I baked a lot just to try those yeast. And so I really don't want to say this is definitive, because I only did it for about, you know, I don't know, a few weeks after I left John C. Campbell, but I went out and bought like as many different kinds of yeast as I could, and I tried different ones. You know, I never did more than two yeast at one time. Maybe I just failed to find, you know, two that were different enough. So there may be differences if you go into it longer, but I didn't see enough of a difference, you know. If it's not vital, big difference, you know. Make sure your yeast is good. There's lots of call for proofing yeast, you know, putting it in the water first to make sure it's proofed. And proof, by the way, I'm going to use that term. That's the only, hopefully, the only baking jargon I'm going to use. But proof is simply, for proofing the yeast, it's pretty obvious. When you put the yeast in, it comes alive. You've proved that it's good, right? But you're also proofing bread when you raise it. So when I say now we're going to proof it, we're raising it, okay? So that's the term that bakers use for raising the bread, okay? Anyways, because I keep my yeast either in the freezer or the fridge, I don't really have to worry about whether it's good or not. And I'm just not happy with how the yeast cakes up. Eventually it works out in the dough, but it just bothers me. When you throw yeast on water, you get this kind of dry center sometimes, these little lumps. They do work out, I know that, but I don't like it, so I don't do that. I always put my yeast after I've got flour in. It's fine to do it either way. Obviously, this time, you didn't have a choice. You got, you know, your yeast in with the dough. So we got the yeast and the salt and the water in here now, right?
Right.
Okay, cool. All right, so now there is nothing else that I need to worry about putting in here. I will measure nothing more. I'm simply going to use flour and put it in it, and that's it, okay. Now, one last word about choices of flour. Is there anybody here who just wants to bake with whole grain, doesn't want to do white flour baking?
Okay.
Yeah. I encourage you to use whole grains as much as possible. I try to, if I'm not like doing bread for company, I usually do 100% whole grain, you know. I'm fine with it, but if I've got company coming, want it to be a little more celebratory, I may do, I could even do 100% white bread. This is going to have a nice whole wheat flavor because of the starter, the old dough, but we're going to use white flour for it here. One of the reasons is that you have to bake more slowly, work the bread more slowly if you're using whole wheat flour, because whole wheat flour still has the bran and the germ, and neither of those absorb water nearly as quickly as just the starchy white flour. So a thing to know is if you've baked with whole wheat flour and it always came out too heavy, the odds are very good that even if you understood to try and make your dough a little bit wetter, you were being fooled by the fact that the dough seemed really wet when you put the flour in, and so you had to add more. And then when it was rising, all of a sudden it got very dry. That's because it takes about 10 minutes for the whole wheat flour to completely absorb. So the bulk of your whole wheat flour that you're sure you're going to use, which isn't very much, you know, should go in right away, and you should just let the whole wheat absorb for a while. Then come back and knead, and then you use very little of it. And it's easier in this class for us to use white because we don't have to do that waiting for it to absorb, okay? By the way, these scrapers are most easily available at restaurant supply stores. Does everybody know that on Ashland Avenue, right up by Patton, there's a place called FRS? And that's a restaurant, it used to be Asheville Showcase, and now it's FRS. And they are the place to get these. $1.50 there. Anywhere else, probably $3 or something like that. And usually the wrong configuration. So where to get it is at FRS. It's also where you can get these bowls. I recommend, I'm trying to think of them, that nobody buy a bowl smaller than this one right here. You know, this is the smallest bowl I recommend trying to make dough in.
Is this 18 inches?
No, that's probably only 14, I bet, you know. Yeah, it might be 16, 18 is more like that there, and that's, you know, that's my ideal size. That's the one I like, you know. That's the one that contains my ability to make messes. Yeah. Somewhat, anyways, it doesn't really, I exaggerate, you know. It reduces, you know, it constrains my ability to make messes. Okay, a word about flour. I kind of feel like I'm not being properly local, because my flour is coming all the way from Graham, North Carolina. You know, and the grain, probably a lot of it didn't come from North Carolina, which now there's a lot of North Carolina grain that you can get. Jen Lapidez has Carolina ground, and her flour is excellent. I've used it and I like it, but it takes more attention for me because I didn't use it when I had my bakery, and it needs even more hydration. And if I'm trying to teach, I want something that I know exactly how it's going to perform. So I went with this. This is Lindy Mills. I highly recommend it. The co-op carries it. It also carries Carolina ground. I recommend that you try them all and play with them and find the ones you like the most. Her flour is excellent, and I'm not at all not recommending it. I'm just, you know, making it easy on myself. If perchance you decide to save money on flour and you buy in bulk at the co-op, if you order ahead of time, you can get 20% off for buying a full-size bag. You can't walk in the store and do that because they need to have that supply. But if you get, you know, order ahead of time, you can save 20%. That's a lot of money. And for white flour, which keeps pretty well, it may be wise. I just didn't do what I'm going to recommend to you. If you do that, I always turn it upside down and don't open it on this side because the silly little pour spout, which doesn't work for anything, holds flour and always makes a mess. So if you turn it upside down, you have a neater.
How is the best way to store it?
Store it as cold as you can. And white flour, I've used it a year later and been fine with it, you know. Whole grain flour, if it's not frozen or refrigerated at least, I would not keep it for more than a month to 6 weeks, you know. I try to use it up and not, you know. By the way, if you have flour you think's over the hill and you're a gardener, it's great fertilizer. It's high, it's very fine, so it'll be quickly used by the microbes, and it's always high protein. Even all-purpose flour still has quite a bit of protein, which is nitrogen. So it works fine, you know. Just use it up. Don't throw it away, you know. You could also do paper mache, you know. But don't eat it if it's... Okay, and a way to tell, if you're doing... if you're wondering about your flour, it's on the edge, taste it. It should not taste bitter. You should not eat any grain that tastes bitter. And the most classic culprit, anybody want to guess? Cornmeal. Doesn't lots of cornmeal taste bitter? Don't eat it. It's rancid. It's not good for you. We keep our cornmeal in the freezer. Cornmeal spoils really quickly. Corn grits, they don't spoil that quick. By the time it's ground down to the size of cornmeal, it spoils very, very quickly. Okay, so I've added what I think is like the most I want to put in until I see what happens. And now, yeah, I want people to gather around. I want this flour out of the way. And so all I'm doing right now is kind of folding the flour in, and it's going to need more. But I never start out with too much, even though I could be quick, you know, and take a good guess. If I baked every day, I would, you know, but since I'm not baking every day anymore, I don't do that. I make sure that I'm not going to be adding too much. Now that I can see that this, I definitely could not knead this dough by hand. Indeed, I have not even absorbed all the water, so I'm going to need more flour. But it's enough of a ball that I'm no longer going to be throwing big amounts in. I'll throw moderate amounts in, you know, but not big handfuls, like this much. And I'll immediately show you other people may have this technique. I haven't seen anybody else teach it, but to me it's a critical technique for using less flour. I floured the top of the dough, right? I now flip it. Now the flour is on the bottom. I now fold it on itself. Now the flour is where I work, on the outside, but not on the inside. So I'm now using the flour simply to aid in kneading. I need more flour right away. And I'm not surprised at that because I'm still getting to a point. But pretty quickly you get to a point where you don't need more flour. So I've incorporated as much as I can, and now I'm going to add some more flour. And I know a lot. Pretty quickly you get to a point where instead of doing that, you're doing that. You know?
We're still just making the sponge.
No. The sponge is sitting. You're good. I'm showing you how to make a dough.
Okay, I got you.
Yeah, so I should, yeah, I'm sorry. Well, I am showing you how to do the direct dough method, which is the old dough. The sponge has to rise. Why I want to do that is simply so we can catch it and see what it looks like at the peak. You know, otherwise we'd be doing a direct dough for this too. Okay. Okay. So I've got it on. Now I'm going to flip it. And I can tell, I'm going to be able to, one more time I should be able to start kneading it. I shouldn't need to use my scraper anymore. Okay. As soon as I see that it's tearing a lot, I stop. You don't want to tear your dough. Okay. Remember I said you want to treat it like a living organism? If you tear it, what you're creating is places where it will get wet. You know? And this is the classic one. Somebody gets a great dough, and I said, you can practice a little more. You're kneading. It could be a little bit more well-developed gluten, and you'll learn the feel of it better. And that's a good thing when you're first, once you know how to bake, you just bring it to a place where you can tell it's ready and you're done. But today, you'll go a little bit longer just to learn how to even get it better. But if you don't keep doing that super light dusting, very quickly, a dough that was just properly absorbed feels totally wet again, because you make these micro tears, and they make it feel wet again. And I've seen people get the dough way too over floured because they were kneading when the dough was fine and they weren't doing that dusting which kept it from tearing. You know, if you don't keep, you know, use the flour as a kneading agent so that it doesn't tear. Every tear is bad. I'm not cleaning my hands and I will not tear the dough much because of experience. You might need to clean your hands when you're first trying to learn how not to tear the dough. You might need to clean your hands and oil them several times in the process, okay, till you get comfortable with it, okay? I'm going to go with less flour now. I still know I need enough to be able to work it, but I'm going to see if I can start kneading it now.
Can you show a tear again?
Oh, they're all over the place.
That's
that's a tear. See, when I put my finger down and it pulls it up,
so
it sticks.
Yeah,
that's a tear. Anytime it sticks, it's tearing.
Okay.
Don't, you know, give up because you tore your bread. Just try to do it as little as possible. Yeah. That's all, you know? Okay.
So do you have to oil your hands to knead?
You don't have to, but you'll find it helps you today as you're trying to learn how to do this, you know? I never oil my hands. It's because I know how to have a light touch and not tear it, you know? Okay, see a tear there?
Mm-hmm.
That's a tear, obviously, right? So now it's time to use more flour. That's all, you know? Every time it tears, I know it's time to use more flour. But you see I'm going much less flour now? Okay, and now I still need this to flip it. It's not as far along. I always flip it so that the flour is on the bottom. And when I fold it, I'm not folding as much flour in. It's starting to tear immediately, so I need more flour.
So it'll stick to the pan too.
It'll stick to the pan too if you don't get enough flour on. But what you want to avoid is being sure it doesn't tear and overdoing the flour. The goal is to use just enough flour, never more. And I really should clean this and oil it so it's not tearing it, you know? And I recommend that you do that. Right now, for the purpose of this demonstration, we will not be doing that, you know?
So can you, just flour that?
It'll help, yeah, you could. So you see my motion? Mm-hmm. Every time I flip it, right, I turn the bowl a quarter turn, okay? I always fold it to me, push it away with the heel of my hand, okay? Don't be heavy-handed, you know? You want to get some motion on the dough, but if you're heavy-handed, you'll bury it into there and tear the dough every time. It doesn't take a lot of power to do it. My first baking class at John C. Campbell, I had a pretty famous potter, locally famous, you know, regionally famous, Mary Dashiel, and her comment at the end of the class was, I love that I learned I don't have to wedge my dough. You know? Because she just was killing herself and her dough, you know, because she was thinking of it as clay. It's not clay, you know, it's a living organism. Can you see that it's pretty resilient? It's not really, it's stuck there, so it's time to stop. But I'm definitely now at the, I call that fairy dust. You want fairy dust. I flipped it. By the way, if you over flour, I have my metaphor for this too, I'm going to tell you to go to hell. or at least purgatory. Because what you have to do if you over flour is come back and dimple it, pour water on it, walk away, let it sit and absorb in for a while, and then begin to knead it again, and it's a sticky mess. But very quickly, if you then walk away after you've kneaded it for a little bit, it'll start to feel much better, and it won't be sticky because it'll absorb in, okay? So it's sticking slightly more. I'm going to dust it. But I'm trying to use less and less flour now. Can you see? Because there's room over here where you might be able to see better. You know, I want everybody to actually see this. See how little flour I'm putting on? Now I pat it. That means I've spread it out so I don't have spots that are going to stick, you know? And then quick flip, right? slight dust. That was actually more flour than I wanted to use. And we're actually probably, this dough is probably getting close to ready. It doesn't take a whole lot. Okay, it's stuck. See how fast it came back?
Yeah.
Everybody see that?
Yeah.
If I do it now, watch. It doesn't come back as fast. So you have to do it the instant you stop kneading if you want to tell if your dough is ready, okay? And all the time, somebody, pardon?
You're waking up the fairies with the fairies.
Yes, right? Yeah, very good. I hadn't read that one. Well, all the time what will happen is somebody will say, is my dough ready? And I'll say, how long since you stopped? Because by the time I get to them, they have to knead it again or I can't tell, you know? Saw how fast it came back? That's what you're looking for. This dough's fine. It's done. It's actually can stand to have a little bit, teeny bit more. I don't want wet spots, so I'll knead it for another moment or two. And that's just me being compulsive, though, because it'll absorb. Those wet spots will dry out. I just always feel better if I have it so that I don't have a wet spot. So I'll do it like another knead or two. But it's done, and I want you all to feel it. I want you all to, this now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to knead, and I'm going to have each of you whack it, okay? Touch it to see if it's done. Okay, now. See how fast it's coming back? All right. No, I'm just going to leave it like that. Two can go for it at once, okay? All right, go for it. See how fast it comes back? All right.
So you only have to worry about tearing, like, in the beginning? Because, I mean, to me, it just looks like there's tears all over, you know?
Okay. How you would be in trouble is if I said, knead it more just so you develop, because you could knead this more and you develop the gluten even more, and that's a good thing, it's fine, but I know this will work great. Why it'll work great, too? I'm actually going to make it, put on the web so everybody can look at it, a little thing I've written. Right? And in what I wrote, I said that, you know, if you learn all the processes and can ace some of them, you'll have darn good bread. You know? So, if you don't develop the gluten perfectly, but you have a perfect oven with perfect bottom heat, then it'll still rise wonderfully. I know we're going to be baking in a wood-fired oven. I don't have to sweat the gluten as much. You know? This is plenty developed. You know? But if you had a home oven and no baking stone, then you'd probably really want to ace the proofing and ace the kneading because you don't have your massive bottom heat. So you've lost one of your tools, you know? So that's it. That's why this is, I call this artisan baking, because you get all the tools that an artisan develops. And then it doesn't matter where you are on the spectrum of artisan, as you use those tools to do your very best and to learn from the products you're working with, you're being an artisan. You know, you may be a beginning artisan, but you're being an artisan.
You know? So it sounds like if you're using a home stove, that having a stone in it's going to help you get
totally, absolutely. And by the way, I picked up an $8 baking stone. So if somebody doesn't have a baking stone and needs one, I don't need it. I just figured I'd seize the moment. I don't need to sell it. I can always have it. Somebody someday will say, "Gee, I don't have a baking stone." I'll say, "I got one." You know?
Is that like a pizza stone?
Yes, a pizza stone. Okay. Yep. Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to come towards the next people to feel two people. Okay, go for it. See how fast it's coming back? Okay.
It's like Granny's cheek.
Yeah, that's what you want. Exactly. You got it. Yeah, all right. Good. That's exactly what you want. You want it to feel a lot. That's too hard. Use your fingers like this, okay? Yeah. Don't hit it quite so hard. You don't need to. It'll give you a false read. So I guess if you do it all the time, it won't matter, you know? Okay. Come on in. See how fast it comes back?
It really does, yeah.
That's what you want. You want it to come back that fast, you know? If you've really been, you know, developing it and not tearing it up, you know, see, that's where you'd be in trouble. If I was telling you to develop it more, when you said you see those tears everywhere and you didn't keep flowering, these little tiny things you call tears, it's not a tear to me unless it was caused by me catching the dough and pulling it off. That's the tear, you know, when I actually tear it. The imperfections, they're not tears, they're just wrinkles, you know? But if you kept kneading without using flour, you'd get tears. And then your dough would suddenly be wet again. You'd say, it's all wet again, I need more flour. You need more flour because you need to use the teeniest amount to avoid getting those tears. You know, the tears are when my hand hits the dough. I can't even get one right now, you know? But my hand hits the dough, there it did. That, you know, that's a tear. See how my hand pulled up and tore the dough? That's what I mean by a tear. The wrinkles and stuff in there, they're not tears. You know, they're just, you know, you're not, you know, it may look, I may feel like Granny's cheek, but it's not going to have the same look, you know. I still need my scraper underneath. Okay. You really do want to try and make a dough. This dough, I actually think I could have made even wetter, even though everybody now can just feel how supple it is, you know. If you're making doughs that don't feel, you know, really, you can give it a squeeze now, you know, if you're making doughs that don't feel at least that supple, they're not going to be nearly as good, okay? They need to be that lively, and indeed, I want it even more lively than that. If I had time right now, I would soak this a little bit and go back and rehydrate it. You know, I went a little bit too far in trying to teach, you know. Not by much. I know this will make an excellent baguette, you know. But I like it, you know. As an artisan, I like to push it to where it is just so alive, you almost think it's like going to jump up and bite you, you know, or kiss you, right? We'll say that rather than bite you, okay? Okay, so basically, what I just did is what you're all going to do. Any questions? Did everybody get enough feel? Okay, because what I'm going to ask is for you to tell me when you think it's ready, and then I'll come check it with you, okay? But you want to do that, and you can test it all the way along, you know, you don't have to do it, you know, only after a long time of kneading. It can develop very quickly. Okay, now this is, I'm going to tell you ahead of time, and some of you may decide just to sit down and not learn how to knead, because you can make bread without kneading. Time will do the same thing. Indeed, there's another term and technique invented, maybe just written about. I don't know if he invented it, but he made it like, you know, official and all that, and he calls it autolyzing. And it's Professor Cavell in France. And what he figured out was that if you do, it only works in direct dough, right? If you take all of the flour that you know you're going to use in your recipe, you know, which is not as much as is in the book at all, right? But enough that you get a very rough, shaggy dough, right? And the water, and just that, mix them up and walk away for 20 minutes. When you come back, much of the gluten development has been done just by sitting there and aligning itself. If you then come in, knead it for a minute, or a half a minute, or 10 seconds, walk away, give it 20 minutes, incredibly more developed. So you can simply work your dough a teeny bit every once in a while, or not at all, and wait longer, and the gluten will develop. Okay? You don't have to knead. Kneading, I like it. To me, it's an essential experience. And I'm in touch with my bread that way. I know I've got my hydration right, and it speeds the process up. You don't have to wait as long to get to where you're going. But if you're home for the day and have a lot else to do, you know, you're working editing something or whatever, you know, don't have time to knead, then you can simply let it all, you know. You have to remember, though, once you've done that, you have to put the rest of the ingredients in. You know, don't forget and just say, okay, it's ready. Now I'm just going to do a little bit of kneading and shape it, and then why didn't it rise, you know? So you have to then remember that what I recommend if you're doing that is have your ingredients measured out so you see them. And you don't miss them. You know, that's really, it's a good way to do it. We don't have enough little containers here. That's why Andrew's going to do the measuring, so everybody, you know, comes in and gets a hit for it. So do people feel ready to try it? Okay. Okay, come on around, folks. I didn't catch it on the peak. I misjudged how long. It's already fallen. Okay? See what I mean by fallen, though? Can everybody tell that it's fallen?
The fissures in the middle were
certain. Yeah. And when it first falls, it'll just be the teeniest little sag, a sigh, you know? But you'll be able to tell, I mean, as you watch it. It'll be mounded when you catch it on the rise, you know? So now you know what not to do, you know? Which is almost as good as teaching you what to do. But then as you do the sponges, pay attention, call me over when you think it's at their, we'll catch some that are at their peak.
Yeah. You can resurrect that, I would think, by making your sponge bigger right now.
You think so? I'm not sure that you haven't fed somebody who is not as good for your dough. I think it's not just that you lost the power of the current microbes, but I think you've begun to favor a community that is not as powerful.
Well, what I've done in a situation where I grossly overdid
Is
then I took a little bit and then
use that.
Totally.
Yeah. And that worked fine.
This is the thing. Okay, what he's doing then is he's turning his failed sponge into a starter. Now you've just added another artisan technique.
Right.
You know? And indeed, the dough you used for old dough, started as a starter. And that, I didn't care at all about it falling. Because that was a starter. That was just like the old dough. There's no power left in the old dough by the time you get done tearing it up. You know, I saw you tearing the dough up and all that. And even though I knew it was fine for that, because I hate to see gluten damaged, it was almost painful. You know, it's not. You were doing a fine thing because you don't want power in that. You want the fermentative results. You want the dough conditioning results. You know, so once again with that, you know, it doesn't matter if you use it as a starter, but as a sponge, this will never be as good as it could have been. What I'll ask right now, Tom, is will you add some more flour and the salt into that and the olive oil? You know, keep it good and wet. I want to show it being made. You know, I'll demonstrate making a dough again. But what I'm going to ask first, though, is that we go back. Oh, by the way, this is the sourdough that I have for you all to take home. And it already needs to be fed. And I can tell, if you all look, see the little bubbles and the kind of foam, that means that it's gone too far and needs to be fed. Here's rye flour, I think, or is that whole wheat? That's whole wheat. I guess whole wheat's fine. Yeah, whole wheat's fine. I prefer rye because it ferments better, but it ferments faster. This starter, by the way, was spectacular yesterday. What I teach you is you want to have it, you don't want to ever have tons of starter. A little bit of starter that you keep really young is what you want. You know, if you keep feeding by the cup, you need to start a chain letter. You know, because you just can't use that much starter, so you got to send it off to somebody and tell them they're going to be unlucky if they don't use it or something. You know, and so rather than do that, I say keep a very small amount and feed it. I only made a lot so that you all could see it and then be able to take some home. But what I want is to take it out of the fridge or start it up and get it just before I bake so that it doubles in bulk within a couple hours, which is what you're going to want for your bread. If it's not doing that, it's not going to give you a satisfactory bread. This was almost tripling in bulk within less than 2 hours. You know, I went out to get a haircut, stopped at Goodwill. By the time I came back, if I can get the picture up to show you, it was going a little bit too far. But it wasn't so bad because when I redid it, it did the same thing. You know, and right now I'm not feeding it a lot, so it should get to where I can show you that again pretty quickly. If I was feeding it a lot, I'd add more water too. A way to slow it down is more flour, less water. A way to speed it up is less water, more flour. I mean, more water, less flour.
We knew what you meant.
Yeah. Okay. So that's the starter. We'll talk more about starters probably during the meal, you know, because this class really doesn't have time for sourdough, mm-hmm. You know. But I want you to learn it as much as possible. Okay. So I'm teaching you this technique. When you leave here, use whatever the heck technique you want. You know, use the tools I've given you for telling when it's ready and stuff like that. But you may decide you don't like to knead this way. There's no proper way to knead. As long as you get the gluten developed, you know, it doesn't matter. Just keep adding flour till you're getting close to a dough. You know, I mean, you know, I want you to be cautious, but it also has to be a dough. You know,
gotcha.
It's not going to work. Folks, don't keep beating the batter up. You have to get enough flour in to have a dough. Do it in one cup increments so you don't get too far. But you're going to need to get enough in to make a dough. You know, yeah. This one here, Camille, you're at a point where you might start thinking about how much flour you put in. You know, everybody else is still getting past the batter stage, and just go for it. Dump it in there until you're well past the batter stage. Cynthia, dump it into your at least at that stage. You know, don't just dump it. You know, if you only have a cup in there, you know, if you only have a cup, you can just dump it in there. Folks, can everybody just come here and look for a minute? Keep doing what you're doing, okay? What he's doing is actually a mistake. Okay? It's okay. It's not a huge mistake, and everybody else would make it too, you know, and thank you for making it so I can teach from it. Keep showing it, though. Because what he's doing is he's tearing the gluten. You want to get enough flour in that you don't have that kind of stretched tear. Can I use it for a minute? You know? When you do this, that's the perfect way. See how it's stretching up and then it tears? You know, you don't want to catch it and stretch it. You want to make one organism that doesn't stretch and tear. So get enough flour in that doesn't happen. Okay? See how I'm not getting nearly as much tearing as you are?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm quickly getting it to be a dough, okay?
But still needs a...
Yeah, it needs more flour.
Flour.
But less motion and, like, make each motion move you another stage along, okay? All right, try it now. You do it. Add some flour. But at this point, try and spread the flour over the whole thing and use your hands so you don't dump too much in, okay? Now just try and fold that over on itself. Just one quick flip over. Okay, now come from the other side. Yeah, flip it over. Okay, now come, turn it again. Okay, now actually it's wet enough. I just go ahead and add more flour, you know. But pretty quickly, see, I'd use your hand. You cannot be precise enough with that.
Right.
You're past the dump stage. Now you're at the proper placement because you want the flour everywhere. You're looking to make it. You've almost got a dough, so you don't want to waste flour. We want each bit of flour to work to help you to get something you can work the dough more with, okay?
So
now flip it on itself. Do it again, quarter turn, yeah. Flip it on itself, quarter turn. All right, now you want to just keep doing that. Get more flour, another cup, and put it so that it's covering the whole thing, and try to get it like I got it, where it's actually a dough, where you have very little tearing. You know, I'd clean this off so you're not sticking, you know. Dust liberally, because you're still very wet. Now, clean that so that you don't tear, okay?
Like go clean it, or?
Yeah, well, you can clean it. I'll clean it for you right now, okay? Enough, well enough, okay? Once you're trying to do this yourself, I'd recommend you keep it really good and clean. Maybe get a towel, or tape a towel or something, wipe it down really well. All right, now what you wanna do, right, since you have something you can actually flip, is, and I'm gonna do it the first time for you, okay? And if you'll just watch too, okay? And you can watch too. I'm just gonna free it up. And see, I'm kind of getting the dough, so the flour spread around when I've done that. Flip it, and now flip it on itself. So now the flour is mostly on the outside. I can work it for a while, right? Now I'll do flour on top again, flip it, and do that again, right? So you don't want inefficient motions. You're trying to free it up and flip it. Go for it. But what you should have done before you did that, right, was be sure that you had flour covering the entire area, okay? Now try and flip it, okay? Yeah, fast motion, spin it around real quick, and then go for it. Just go for it. Yeah. And you didn't, I knew you weren't really going to be able to flip that, but I wanted you to get the feel for it. Yeah. So you know it's got to be a little bit denser before you flip it, okay? All right, here's your thing. Just go back to what you're doing, okay?
Put a little more flour on that, right?
Yeah. Okay, folks, once you have a dough, you're no longer dumping. You're using your hand to place it strategically. It's now a kneading agent, right? It's no longer an ingredient. It's a kneading agent, okay? Okay, you're good. So what you didn't get right there? Okay. Mind if I show you?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. You don't need much flour now, so I'm just going to do a dusting, right?
Okay.
A little more than that probably, but I can get away with the dusting. I want you to put most of the flour on it, okay?
Okay.
I did get it on you, though. Yeah, I warned you, right?
Good.
Okay, now, and you should clean your thing, too, because you see how it's sticking to the thing?
Yeah.
Okay, I completely free it, right? But it's that confidence that you can do it. You quickly free it. You don't sweat. Did I get every last bit done? And then the flip, okay? But this is really causing you a problem. So take hers, clean it off, you know? If you're having a lot of trouble, oil your hand, oil it, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Doing?
You're looking good. You're looking good. You got to be very careful now.
Okay. Not, okay.
You need very, very, very little more flour now. You're at this stage of flour, okay?
Okay. How do we deal with, you know, getting everything so sticky? Was that something we probably should have oiled our hands?
It would have been easier.
It would have
been easier. You can
get
away.
Don't worry about it.
The longer you're at it, but right now I clean them because you'll tear less, you know?
Okay.
But let me show you right now how much flour you're going to be doing from now on, okay? Like that.
Wow. Okay.
Okay.
Gotcha.
And that allows you to knead for a long time.
Right.
You can't.
Then we flip it and then knead.
Yeah. It's very hard to put too much flour in at that rate, you know?
Okay.
But you can knead it every time, the minute it sticks at all, just do it again.
Okay.
But that teeny amount of flour, but well distributed, and to be sure it's distributed well, pat it around.
Gotcha.
Okay?
Did you always flip with the little fin?
Well, eventually you get it so ready that you don't need the thing anymore,
okay,
you know? But don't bother to not use it. I mean, always use it until you don't need it,
okay,
you know? Don't think, oh, I should be at the stage where I don't need it anymore.
Okay.
You can knead it for the whole thing, it's okay. I'm using very little flour. You could use more, but I want you to do that, not me. So I'm going to use very little. All right, so free it, the whole thing, flip it, okay? Don't try and turn it.
Uh-huh.
Pick the whole thing up and flip it. It's plenty wet and needs more flour because that tore as I did that, okay? So now plenty of, you know, but plenty is a relative term. Plenty enough to get what you need. All right, try to, can I have the flour? Try to do it like this. So you get a good, more coverage rather than sprinkling it on, and then pat it around. Now, try flipping it.
So now I got to loosen it or flip
it
first?
Loose it and flipping it. You always loosen it, yeah, turn it. Solid motion underneath every time. All right, one more, flip it. All the way under and flip it. You're not, what you're trying to do, right, is flip it without picking it up. You're picking it up and flipping it, okay? Try it now. You don't even shouldn't have to flour, just go ahead and try it. Free it up. Now go for it. Get the whole thing, pick it up, and flip it. That's the idea, okay? All right. Yeah, you can knead at this point, okay? So you got plenty of flour on there. Now you're just going to do the pull to you, push away, pull to you, push away. As soon as you stick, lightly flour, flip it, pull to you, push away. Yeah. Yeah, you look like you're getting there too. Are you at a kneading stage?
I think so.
Okay, so you're going to flip that. First you're going to do this, right? Get the flour all over. Okay. Now flip it. Very good. All right. Now take that, pull it to you. Push it back with the heel of your hand. Push it to you. Yeah, right. That's it. That's it. Yep.
And then when it sticks.
When it sticks, fairy dust. Fairy dust. You're at a fairy dust stage. You do not want to use very much at all. Okay? But you got the motion. You're good. You want to.
Like that?
Yeah. And actually, go ahead and flip it. I want to show you one thing about the motion. Okay? Pretty soon you won't need that scraper, but you still do it right now. Yeah. Okay, good. Try to get. I don't know. Okay, that's. I thought there was something, but it's just a little. It's just the way it's. You know, it's not anything. Okay. Try to get a little more action from each dough. Okay. You know, like roll your hand across the. Don't bury it in, but just stay with it a little longer.
Okay.
If you stay too long, you'll stick. So learn how to stay with it long enough to get some motion across the bowl, and then come up fast off it. Okay.
Okay.
You're looking good though. Yeah. You could have flipped with your hands. Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. So, but one thing. See how you ended up there?
Uh-huh.
Come around and start that way now.
Okay.
So you're working it across the bowl. You want to be able to pull it across the bowl. You don't want to come up the sidewall. Okay, now push it. Through. You're a little bit too afraid of this, Lee. It's more like this.
Okay.
Okay, now try it.
So it's really a fold, that first one.
Yep.
Pick up and fold.
Yeah, and then push it away.
Okay.
But every time, instead of going sideways, turn it. So you're always coming from one side.
Okay.
Okay. All right, now you try it. That's it. That's it.
David's a potter, so unfair advantage there.
Well, it's like Mary. Mary's a friend of mine. So, yeah, you don't want to, it's a very different beast, isn't it?
It is totally,
so
yeah.
So it's just starting to stick a little bit.
That means you fairy dust.
Fairy dust.
Fairy dust, right? Yeah, it's pretty good, except you did it all over there.
Well, you know, I got to start somewhere.
But you had good technique. It's just bad aim, you know?
No, I want to.
But yeah, yeah.
Oh, isn't that pretty?
Yeah. Okay. You guys are perilously close to going to hell.
Well, we're not going to go past. We're
so you just have to be the least little fairy dust, okay?
Okay.
Yeah. 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 You've got all the flour you need there, okay?
You're scared now.
Yeah.
You've got to pick up the whole bowl.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a very nice dough. Yeah. Very good. Whose dough is this? That's mine. That's what it is, right? Like, why isn't that being done? That's me, you know? By the way, folks, when I teach at John C. Campbell, I start those and never finish them, and then I come up to them later on, and they've developed themselves, and I'm right up with everybody else, you know, because I needed them a little bit. That's all it took. If I have a chance, I might come back and do this for a moment, you know, but I don't need to keep kneading it because it'll knead itself.
Yes, it
is. You had just floured the top, right?
Yes.
Okay. If you flour the top, then you don't fold it. You flip it completely, and then you fold it.
I did. I thought I flipped. Right.
Oh, you had flipped it?
Yeah.
Okay, then I'm wrong. Pardon me. Pardon me. See, I said you just floured the top, and you said yes.
Oh, no.
Yeah, all right. You do. Okay, so you're good. Yeah, let me just watch how you do it. Yeah. No, I see. Yeah, from that end. You always take it far away from you, pull it to you, and then roll it across the bowl with the heel of your hand. Nope.
Oh,
heel of your hand now. Roll it across the bowl. But you need to flour more. You're not quite there, you know? So you'd just be doing a little more folding, but very soon you will be, okay? But the motion is, once you've flipped it, pull it to you so that those mostly at this end, lightly with the heel of your hand, roll it across the bowl, okay? Don't stay on it so long you stick, come off it fast, but try to stay with it as long as you can and get that motion across the bowl, you know? It's not that important, you know? I mean, you'll get it, you know? If you don't have perfect technique at once, the dough will still develop.
Hand has to learn it. That's
yeah, totally,
it is,
yeah. Yeah, that's it. And take advantage of the fact that it's so cold out to warm your house with your oven for at least several batches of dough so that your body retains the motions you've learned today. If you don't have time and go back to your houses and don't get to bake for a month, you'll be further along than you were before, but you won't have retained everything that you got here. All right, if that sticks, you free it up with this. That's all. Don't tear. Just there's no rule that says you can't.
A second ago, it didn't stick.
That's okay. That happens. It's from working it. No big deal. Just go ahead and flip it. Yeah, all right. Then start there. Nope, no. So once you flip it, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm on this side, you would be doing from this side, okay? Right. You'd reach to here, I reach to there, right? Mm-hmm. I pull it to me, so my dough's at this side of the bowl, and then I push it across the bottom of the bowl. Then I turn it a quarter turn. Mm-hmm. I've got this long dough again, I fold it to me, push it across the bowl, okay? At this stage, because you've got a well-developed dough, it's like this. That much. Fairy dust. Right now, pat it around so it's everywhere. Now flip it.
Flip it or move
it? Yeah, flip it. Always flip it. Okay, so let's talk about this.
With
okay?
the thing or?
If you need the thing, you use it. If you don't need it, you don't. So why do I want you to flip it now?
So it would land on the flower side.
Flower side would be on the bottom, mm-hmm. and when you fold it on itself, you're not folding flour in. You're keeping it on the outside where you need it. Okay, you're using it as a kneading agent, not as an ingredient anymore. If you don't flip it, then when you fold it, the flour's on the inside. You want it on the outside. Okay, so now flip it. So what I'd say, since you had to work that hard to do it, mm-hmm. use a scraper. It'll go faster.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
You don't have. There's no rule that says you shouldn't use a scraper. Use a scraper whenever it helps you.
Whenever.
You don't need any more flour now.
No. Okay.
Now, you pull it to you. And roll it across the bowl. Right, okay, now. All right, now let me show something about your motion, okay? Your motion is more down. My motion is more rolled across the bowl. See, try that. That's it. Okay, great. Yeah. And then every time you do that, though, you have a long, like, okay, so you're starting to stick a little bit. So let's go ahead, try the fairy dust. Try fairy dust. Just stop. Not that you're wrong. I just want to watch you while you're doing it, okay? Yeah. If you think your dough is pretty close to done, stop and let me watch your final technique, okay?
Like a frisbee? Yeah.
Okay.
That's too
like,
much.
Yeah, all right,
let
so.
Let's see how you do this. Yeah.
Okay? Okay? And then pat it around. Okay. Now, I do this, it'll just go faster. You know, I'm sorry, not yours, but yeah. Quick, firm, rapid motions. Yeah, go ahead, grab it and flip it. All right. Now, that's the nice longest end. Now take this. You don't need any flour now. The flour is always on the outside, not on the inside, right? This is now going to be the inside.
That's right,
take
that's
this
right.
and fold it to yourself there. And then roll it across the thing. All right. Take it to you. Roll it across the thing. Take it to you. Yeah, okay. So what you're doing, though, yeah, so you got to flip it again. But what you're doing is you're not actually getting as full a fold. Get it all the way folded, right? Then roll it across. All the way folded. Then roll it across. And see, that little tear didn't matter. You know,
uh-huh.
if you have the right technique, okay? You're there, by the way. Just, I'm sure your dough is going to be fast enough. Knead it for a couple of moments while I look at her, and then stop me from help. Just say, Pat, look here, and we'll hit it together, okay?
Okay?
Fairy dust. Okay, let's work on your fairy dust technique here, okay? Okay? Pat it around. I was doing much better dust with him. Yeah, flip it with your hand if you can, but if not, use a scraper. You're good. You can flip it. Okay. All right, so this is good, but that's better. If I spin it around this way, it's a little narrower and longer, and that'll make a nicer, easier way to do it. Okay, yeah. Very good, except for you ended up, once you flipped it, you kind of had moved it in the middle of the bowl. The ideal is to bring it to the side of the bowl so you have lots of room to roll it across. Okay, now let's go ahead and try it. Perfect. You're perfect. You got
okay.
it. Yeah. And your dough's looking good.
It's too wet.
No, it's not. It is not too wet at all. It is exactly what you want moisture-wise. Just see if your gluten is well enough developed, okay?
So, is it ready? You're saying?
You want to knead it and then do the push test and make sure that it's coming back really fast. And that's how it's ready. So you're going to show me if you think it's ready. So knead it now until you know, if you push it now, it's too late.
Okay.
So you got to knead it the minute you stop, push it. If it comes back real fast, then you know it's ready. Say, Pat, I think it's ready. Then I'll give it a quick knead and tell you if you're right.
Should I fairy dust it again?
Yeah, I'd probably,
I think so,
very, very, you want the lightest of fairy dust, you know? Because you don't need any more at all. Okay, you know what? Very good style.
Okay,
you know? And that's how they do it on TV, you know? I'm actually going to tell you a story about that one time. At Highland Lake, someone was doing something like that. She was showing a technique that I taught her, and her style was great, but she did everything else wrong. You know, but for TV, it worked, you know? Okay, so I didn't have enough flour, but that, see how little went on there?
Yeah.
That's how much. Then pat it around. You basically just hit one little swath.
Yeah.
You know, so to get it to spread out more. Now you're fine, okay? Okay, great. Stop.
And ideally, you can eat it like four times.
No, you're good. Now test it. What do you think?
Sort of, I guess, right?
What do you think? Yeah, at home, you can't ask me. What do you think? What do you think?
I guess it's not quite fast enough, right?
It's fast.
You're good. You could stop easily now, okay. And it'll be fine, because you're going to get every other part of the process right. But you're at the edge of done. You could take it further, and for practice right now, you should. But you must do nothing but fairy dust. You need no more flour here. You must ace the fairy dust, okay? All right. You're getting sticky, and that's this. So, I'm sorry, your name again is?
Pavel.
Pavel. Pavel was the perfect example of what happens. His dough is darn, it actually would have been ready when he tested it, right? But as he was working it so he could test it, he was getting the not using enough kneading aid, and it's getting wetter and wetter, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
That's because you have to do that excellent fairy dusting every time. The minute it sticks, you can't let it stick once, okay? So you fairy dusted it, now you can flip it and knead it, and you'll be able to tell if it's done, okay? Yeah, you're good. Go ahead. All right, okay. Fairy dust. Yeah, you'll get it eventually. But okay, what you're trying to do with it is you're trying to lead it out like this, whereas I'm doing is my hand's flipping it out, you know, like that. Okay, go ahead and flip it. Flip it. Okay. Turn it. Okay, yeah, all right.
I guess now it's coming up there.
Okay, so while you're sticking is your motion, right, is a kind of grab, and you're grabbing it, whereas what I'm doing is simply using the heel of my hand to roll it across. I'm not grabbing it at all, right? I have much less contact. Just the part that I need, the heel of my hand, is what's doing it, okay? So you want to probably, well, you can do it now, yeah. That's good. That's much more the technique. The minute it tears, you'd want to do it again, but... You want to get to where we can test it for sure. Go ahead and keep trying. Stand closer, maybe. You know, for your thing, because you're missing the back. Aim for this side. Okay, good. Now just spread that around. Go ahead, flip it and knead it. Okay, good. But you're grabbing it again. Heel of the hand, right? Like that. Okay? No fingers in it, just heel of the hand, that's it. All right, now let's do the test. What do you think? Test it, hit it with your hand. What do you think?
It's a little slower than Camille's.
Yeah, you can. And you know what's happening with you?
Uh-huh.
You're getting a little bit too much flour in there.
That's what I was thinking.
So, you're not bad. Leave I don't
well
think, I don't. What I'd say is I would wet my fingers a teeny bit and just tap it on there, fold it on itself, and walk away for 5 minutes. Then come back and knead it, and you'll get that bounce back, okay? All right. Okay.
Well, yeah, I mean, you could put a little teeny bit more flour on there.
Yeah, you definitely can. And to be able to knead, you can continue to do fairy dust, okay? You're in very good shape, though. Your dough feels very nice. Okay?
Is that where you learned it?
Okay, what do you all think? Have you done the test?
We passed. He gave us thumbs up.
Okay. Yeah. All right, good. All right. Well, then you don't need me.
Yeah, we do.
We can't eat it yet.
Right. What do you think? Are you done?
I think so.
You're good? Okay, all right,
yeah,
cool.
We did our little
all right, good.
Test.
All right. Cynthia, how are you doing? It feels great. Feels wonderful. But go ahead and dust it and knead it, and we'll see if it comes back quick enough. Did you already do that with her?
Yeah.
And she's coming back good?
I think so. I've done it with so many people. I think it was ready, but maybe not.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So work towards eventually getting this technique. Yeah. Okay. You're good, though. You have plenty of flour. You don't need more. Go ahead. Flip it and give it a quick knead. Yeah. Okay. So what do you think? Go ahead, do it yourself.
It's coming back.
It's ready, you're fine. But what I wanted to show you as far as technique, okay, is you aim when you flip it to end up with the dough at this side of the bowl, and then to roll it across the bowl with your hand.
Okay.
And flip it, right? Right? and then roll it across the bowl. That's what you aim for.
And that little bit of stickiness on the bowl, it's all right?
Once you're accomplished. When you're learning, you want to avoid it, right? But once you're accomplished, you can easily get away with it, no problem.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah. Because I know you said the dough should be wetter than we're used to.
Yeah, and this is, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's what you want.
I don't want to make it too dry.
This is a good, you totally tell them. That's why you're only using fairy dust to get your kneading to where you want. Okay, so I think everybody's done. I guess you still had to, you're letting yours rehydrate a little bit, but you're essentially done, okay. All right. Does everybody have a feel for how to not get too far? You know, how to keep your doughs feeling nice and supple and alive? You know? Do these doughs feel different than you've done before?
Yeah.
Okay. Yours feels really nice. Did Andrew test? Were you coming back fast?
What?
You know, the finger.
Yes.
Yeah, you're coming back fast. Okay, good. Yeah, yeah. Feels really nice.
Yeah. It feels so sticky.
Okay. So Camille says it still feels sticky. You've been kneading it, right?
Yes.
Okay. As you knead it, even when you don't know it, you're making micro tears. That's what makes it feel sticky. That's why, in order to knead it, you have to always do that angel dust. Or not angel dust, pardon me, fairy dust. You know? Angel dust, we stay away from here. Fairy dust, right? If you do angel dust, go take a different class. But you always do the fairy dust kind of dusting, so that you can knead it and have no effect on how much flour is in there. But you're not tearing it, because the tear, it's not really getting stickier. You're just tearing the surface so it feels wet. You know? So it's not that you're, that people say, my dough's getting wetter again. No, it's not. You're just damaging the outer surface and getting to the part that we purposely didn't put more flour in. You know, the outside's gonna be drier because you've been putting the flour only on the outside. Mm-hmm. Okay? So you're fine. You know? And you're gonna feel the difference in a minute or two. So Pavlo actually went a little teeny bit past. Nobody had to go to hell. Pavlo was just looking at the door of purgatory. He wasn't even there yet. He was on the lane leading up to it, you know? Which is actually pretty nice. You know, it's nice territory. You know, it's a nice garden. It's really unfair that you end up in purgatory. So he actually didn't do the dimple thing and put like a tablespoon of water on it or something. He simply wet his hands, dimpled it in, then folded it on itself, and now he's gonna wait. And he'll come back and you'll see the difference will be huge. I mean, it's amazing how just the teeniest little bit of water will change the feel. And it'll feel, it wasn't quite as supple as Camille's. He had somebody who got good hydration to compare to, and he knew his was a little bit drier, and therefore when he pushed it in, it didn't respond quite as fast, because if it's loaded with flour, it can't respond as quickly, okay? But you're looking for that supple, lively response. Okay, I think we're good. Any questions so far, or comments on anything? How things can be better? How I can explain it better? Do we need to take a break? Do people want to, like, you know, take a breath, use the bathroom, whatever? Let's do that, and then we're going to go to making the sponge for the next one. The next thing you're all going to do is you're going to empty your bowls into your bucket. So get all the flour out of your bucket, you know. You can do this after your break, by the way. I'm just telling you what you'll do next, okay? Lightly oil the bucket, and then put your dough in there, and then put a lid on it, okay? And then we're going to... I'm going to start emptying the proof box, and we're going to start getting it to the temperature we want, okay? And the reason you're doing that is we're going to start a sponge in the bowl.